Oh, da wird auch die Wahl schön. Die kennt.
Hi, good evening and namaste. This is Shilpi Mangavasti, founder of SpecialSathi.com. SpecialSathi is an organization founded to address the gaps in the provision of information and services in the field of disability, and more specifically, autism. It's an online portal where people with disabilities can connect with each other, find valuable resources, articles that can help improve their quality of life. We at Special Sathi are celebrating the Mother's Day and the month of May by featuring some amazingly superb mothers and women folk. So I welcome you all to yet another exciting talk with the mother of Neeraj, a visionary, a leader, a revolutionary, and a pioneer in autism space in Indian subcontinent. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome a mother who needs no introduction, Miss Mary Barua. Hi, Mary, welcome to the talk.
Hi, Shilpi. Thank you for having me.
Say hi. Come. Say hi. Say
Hi.
hi, Mary.
Hi, Mary.
Hi, what's your name?
What's your name?
What's your name?
Tell your name.
My name is Mary.
My name is. And why are you upset? Say, it was my computer time and Mama took my computer.
Oh, is it because I delayed it?
See, yes.
Oh, I'm so
Say goodbye.
sorry. Bye-bye.
It's my sleep time.
It's my sleep time.
Okay.
Bye. I didn't get your name, but lovely meeting you.
What's your
Good
name?
night.
Tell your name, Yuan.
Tell your name. It's Malina.
Yuan.
Yuan, yeah. Come, say
Yuan.
bye-bye.
Yuan. Lovely meeting you, Yuan.
Mary, you are a prominent social, yeah. So you are a prominent social entrepreneur and an autism advocate, best known as the founder and director of Action for Autism. And since its establishment, it has been one of the leading organizations in India working towards the welfare of individuals with autism spectrum disorders and their families. Be the range of diagnostic and assessment services, training and education programs, and advocacy initiatives, all that which has been running for so many decades now. So all this we know so far about you, that this vision and the journey wasn't an easy one. I'm sure you must have answered this like billion of times before, but for a special Sathi audience, would you share a bit about your journey, the hardships as a woman and a mother that you have faced while raising Neeraj, and how it has shaped your life?
Okay, so you want me to start by giving a little brief this thing about the
About your
difficulties.
journey, yeah.
See, the difficulties have been different. As you know, my son, I don't know, you may not know, of course, that my son is going to be 43 years now. So, he was diagnosed in 85, so it's been a very, very long time. And the challenges that I had then are very different. The challenges change. They don't remain the same right through life. So the challenges at the time when he received a diagnosis was essentially one of not knowing what this whole thing of autism was, because as you know, there was no internet there. There were no books available. You didn't have the plethora of literature you have now on autism. Very little information. There was hardly anybody in the country who had even heard the word.
Of
So it was
course.
a lack of information that was the biggest challenge. And there were other challenges, like things like, because when you have autism, there is no obvious physical thing telling you that this is a person who has a disability. So the expectation from society is that he should not behave disabled. He has to behave non-disabled. So there's a lot of judgment that comes your way, that of being a poor, bad mother, poor parenting, all that kind of stuff. So those were challenges. There were other challenges, like there's a lot of stigma attached to disability, and there was, at least in those days, and I think it still persists in some places, the belief that if you have a child with disability, it is the tragic end of your life, and you should go around in sackcloth and ashes. So I have had people tell me or make comments like, "Oh, she's got an autistic son, and look at the way she dresses, right? So I'm not supposed to dress properly. I'm supposed to look sad all the time. I'm not supposed to laugh and smile and all that kind of stuff." So those were
Gone, gone
really
on.
good challenges.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the challenge was that there were no services. You know, there's nothing that one knew what to do. Or there was nobody who could tell you what to do. Mm-hmm. There was nobody one could turn to. There was nothing. I think those were really the challenges.
Yes.
And they, of course, change over time. The world is a very, very different place now. Mm-hmm. And the challenges of childhood is different from those of adolescence to those of adulthood and, you know,
I'm sure.
Later life.
Yeah. Wonderful. So talking about the challenges, let's move on to another challenge that you took that was establishing Action for Autism. So I would like to ask, what inspired you to start this organization? What exactly, that's one thing, I generally call it insanity, but apart from being insane, mm-hmm. what's that one thought that came to your mind that, look, this is my calling? What made you lead this path that you had chosen for yourself and henceforth working to help the millions of families through AFA? And what are, again, some of the challenges that you faced in getting it off the ground in reality and setting up?
So I think the one thing that struck me when after I got the diagnosis was the complete, you know, vacuum of information, right? And so my initial thing was in trying to get information out there as much as possible, because I just felt that the situation that I went through in the initial years mm-hmm. is something that parents should not have to go through. The other thing that drove me was that initially when Neeraj had got a diagnosis, in those days it was widely believed that autistic kids were kids that you can just forget about and go ahead and have another kid or put him in an institution. You shouldn't bother about them. So, and, you know, obviously no mother really subscribes to that belief, or no parent, I won't say mother, no parent subscribes to that belief. And as I, it took me a long time to get any kind of, you know, support, mostly from overseas, there was nothing here, and start working with my son, I could see that there is so much you could do with him. And when that penny started dropping, I knew that something had to be done, because there was no reason why parents should go through what I had gone through. There was absolutely no reason, and that had to change. So I think that was really my driving thing, that I did not want parents to go through what I had gone through, and mm-hmm. I wanted there to be something that they could turn to. So that was really what drove me to do what I was doing. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is that, you know, whatever I started, it wasn't that, okay, I'm going to start an NGO and I will get a lawyer and this. It was very organic.
Okay.
This is what I wanted to do. So I started with putting up posters in prominent localities in Delhi. Delhi was very different then. Mm-hmm. Like the Sri Ram Center and the Indian International Center about autism, mm-hmm. Talking to college students about autism, writing articles in newspapers like the Indian Express and things like that about autism and disability to get the word out. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, like starting a magazine, what you call Autism Network now, mm-hmm. I started as Autism News in 1990. Okay. So I started a magazine to get information out to parents, because when I was writing in the newspapers, I was getting parents coming in touch with me, professionals getting in touch with me. Mm-hmm. So all of that was happening. And then there was a kid who came along and the family said, you know, my son had a lot of challenges. I got myself some training and I worked with him and there were positive changes. So other parents came and said, can you help? And I said, I'm not an expert, but I'm willing to give it a shot.
Yeah.
So I'll do it on a trial basis. So I did that. Things changed for them. Mm-hmm. And then a young girl came to me fresh out of graduate school and said, I want to learn how to work with autistic kids. Mm-hmm. And I said, okay, I will train you if you'll work with me. Mm-hmm. And very, very organic. That was really the start of the school Open Door. That was really the laboratory on which we developed the teacher training that we had started in 1995. So that is when our teacher training started, which eventually led to the Diploma in Special Education for Autism Spectrum Disorders under the RCI, which is also something that we advocated for and got it to come about. So everything that we've done has been very organic to address needs that we thought were coming up. So one of the things that we did, you know, training workshops are so common nowadays.
Yes.
There were no training workshops at that time. Okay. So we started did the first training workshop in 1996. We did a 4-day training for parents and a 4-day training for professionals.
Okay.
And we were surprised when we got 80 people attend the one for parents and 30 or 40 for the one for professionals.
Okay, great.
And we did that every year after that. That also was organic. And that started because a lot of parents were coming to me when I'd started this little school. Parents would come and say that, you know, I need help, and I'd give them a lot of information. So I had this Fulbright scholar who was volunteering with me, and she said, Mary, I see you sitting with the parents for 2 or 3 hours telling each parent what to do. And some of the things you're telling them are kind of, some of the things are the same, some are very different.
Mm-hmm.
You want to organize a workshop where you're talking to a whole bunch of parents and addressing their questions.
Yes.
That is how training workshops started. Okay. Now they've become like everywhere.
Yeah.
So we did a lot of those training workshops. We did them every year for many years. I mean, now do multiple training workshops. So everything we did was very, very organic.
Mm-hmm.
And along with that, one of the things that we did was, from the word go, was work on changing policies, getting autism into legislation.
Mm-hmm.
That we started right from the word go from 1994. Because remember the old law act, which is now has been replaced by the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act.
Mm-hmm.
The earlier act was the this is the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act. That was the Persons with Disabilities Act, Equal Opportunities, et cetera, et cetera. So that was being discussed in 1993, 1994. And it came about in 1995. So the aim at that point was to see if I could get autism into that. But that was impossible because we would say, autism? Yeah, autism kya hai? So, you know, there was no question of getting it in then. But in 2000, we got it into the National Trust Act.
Okay.
So making policy changes is critical because that is how systemic changes happen. So that was also an important part of what we were doing. But like I said, Shilpi, everything was very organic. It was not that I had planned, okay, I'll do this and I'll do that. I saw a need and I said, okay, this is what we need to do next.
I think
so that's how everything.
Yeah, I think that was destined. And this is really inspiring. And I'm sure people should acknowledge and appreciate the efforts and the actual hard work, struggle, and blood, sweat that we call everything which goes in making such visions into reality, and can really think of that vision that I need to do this for people, my community. So people should acknowledge, and for all those who are suffering, we as a community should come together and work. So now moving ahead, my next question is about the myths and stigmas. A part of that you have just covered in your previous answer. During your journey and experience, what are some of the most common misconceptions people have about autism that you came across and didn't even approve them? And how do you work to dispel those myths?
See, myths are, again, they are socially driven stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they change over time. When I started, the commonest myth was that autism is a Western condition. I was told that by every kind of person. It doesn't happen in India. There are barely, you know, you're making a big noise about maybe, you know, a handful of people in the country, all that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I could clearly see there were so many autistic kids around, mm-hmm, who had diagnosis of intellectual disability and things like that, but actually were clearly autistic.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I was only a mother. Who was going to listen to me? You know, it would be dismissed.
Mm-hmm.
So that was one of the things. The other one was that autism only happens in educated parents, to educated uh-huh. parents, which is again a load of rubbish.
Yeah.
Autism happens because of parental neglect.
Yeah.
And Shilpi, will not believe you me, that is still a very prevalent belief.
Of course.
That it happens because parents have been ignoring them, because modern mothers have left their children and gone to work.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, one of the things people in our country don't acknowledge is it's not modern mothers who go to work.
Mm-hmm.
It is the poorest mothers who are all working.
The laborers, yeah.
Exactly. It is the poorest mothers in our country that work the most, that are in employment.
Yes.
A population we do not even acknowledge exist.
Mm-hmm.
For us, they are non-existent, invisible.
Mm-hmm.
So then you can sit in an ivory tower and say, oh, working mothers create this, yeah, when it is the poorest mothers in our country who are slogging day to night, right? Mm-hmm. So those were some of the myths that were prevalent then. And of course, the common myths that, you know, you must have looked at a moon during an eclipse and therefore you got a child with autism. And I used to say that the entire Western world should have all the autistic kids in the world, mm-hmm, because they don't believe in this. Or even countries like Japan and all that who don't believe in all of this. Why isn't everybody autistic? Because all the parents were looking at eclipses. Mm-hmm. So, you know, those are the myths that were there. The myths that are more prevalent now are autism can be cured. Mm-hmm. There is a magic pill that will cure it. You do some rubbish like stem cell, or yeah, give them some stupid thing like camel milk, or do hyperbaric oxygen therapy. Yeah. These are just ways for people to make a lot of money.
Of course.
Right. Mm-hmm. And that is all it is. It is means to feed on parental vulnerability, because parents are vulnerable. They are not getting support. They don't know what to do with their children. Yes. Because, you know, how many organizations are there in the country? Maybe 100, maybe 200.
Yeah.
And there is a population of 15 million in the country. What is 2,200 organizations going to do? Nothing. We are a drop in the ocean, right?
Yeah.
And when I started, there weren't even that. But even now, when there are so many, it's a drop in the ocean.
Yes.
So the myths will persist because there are enough people out there wanting to make a quick buck, right? And because autistic kids look like other non-autistic people, there are no obvious markers.
Mm-hmm.
It is very easy to get parents to believe,
yes,
that this will fix them, that will fix them. And so these are the myths that continue even now,
yes,
right? And that autism is curable. And the thing is that autism is a huge spectrum. There are autistic people who can live completely independent lives. I have friends who are autistic. I have colleagues at Action for Autism who are autistic, right?
Mm-hmm.
Who can be very independent, right? Who can lead independent life. They have challenges, but they can manage them. And there are kids like my son who would be, in a typical common parlance, would be called severe autistic and all that, right? And in between, there is an entire spectrum.
Okay.
Now, it is, you do not know which one of our kids will land up how in, yeah, their adulthood, right? There are kids with whom you've done nothing and they're leading independent lives. And then there are kids you've done a lot of stuff and they are not, right? So, of course, if you provide the right this thing, all of them will improve. But sometimes there are kids with whom you can do any rubbish and they're doing okay because that was their potential, inherent potential. And yeah, every individual is different, just like you are different and I'm different. You are great at certain things and I'm rubbish in those. And I may be good in some things and you'll be rubbish in those, right?
True.
So that is why it is very easy to fool parents with all of this. Right. And the other thing is the autistic kids, they have very good rote memory, right? Mm-hmm. So that often is harnessed by people. So when they're little, their rote memory is used and say, oh, they'll go to school and they'll do fine. And we just hold our head and say, I wish these parents wouldn't believe them, because we know they'll come back to us when the kid is 17, 18, yeah, saying what has happened now.
Yeah.
Right? Do help us now. You know, there. I'll give you an example. So there was this family. Here was this kid who even we could see had immense potential, just needed the right kind of support. Mm-hmm. And many of them, if you could give them the right kind of support, you can get them, you know, included very quickly.
Yeah.
But that father, the father in particular, was looking for a magic bullet.
Okay.
And I told him, why are you doing it? And he told me one day, just give me 1 minute, there's an alarm going off there. And So he said that, you know, Mary, if you picked up a pebble from the road and told me that wash it every day and give that water to your son and he'll become all right, I will do it.
Mm-hmm.
And this is an intelligent, successful man running a fabulous business.
Mm-hmm.
He did not listen to us,
mm-hmm,
persisted in all kinds of crazy stuff. He did stem cell therapy because he's got lots of money,
okay,
right? And he believed he was seeing changes because, you know, when you spend a lot of money and you do a lot of emotional investment,
yeah,
you imagine improvement. Mm-hmm. It's human nature, it's psychology.
Yes.
He did all of that. Now the kid is 22. He's come back to us,
oh,
and saying, and he's not the only one. saying, what do I do next? But if he had not done all of that, believe me, this kid would have, of course, he'd still be autistic, but he'd be functioning independently. Even now, we can work with him and take him to that. But look at the time he's lost.
Yeah.
Look at the time he's lost.
Yes, true.
And that's the unfortunate bit.
Yeah. In fact,
so those are the myths, you know, the kind of the magic that will happen if you do this or you do that or do some rubbish. I know parents who actually glorified it over Facebook, taking their kids overseas. Now, if I'm the US, then I'm a special parent. You know, amongst Indians, there is this thing that if somebody overseas, somebody in India telling you something would be rubbish, but somebody overseas telling you rubbish would be great.
True.
So I know mothers and families who've taken the kids overseas, shoved all kinds of treatment up their noses and stuff like that. And people here have worshipped them. And I've been appalled to watch on Facebook. And these are mothers who are very smart and well-spoken and stuff like that. How do you change this?
Yeah.
How do you change this?
Yeah.
Because they are the influencers in our country.
Yeah, true. Yeah. So the mentality and the vulnerability parents that have, and the newly diagnosed parents specifically, they look for miracles. So
absolutely.
Yeah.
They're looking for miracles, yeah.
Yeah.
And you can't blame parents. See, it is up to parents who've got older kids to show the way, to be good examples.
Yes.
But if they are showing, you know, this kind of stuff that, you know, I've done this thing, and this whole thing of, I'm this amazing mom who's doing this. And the thing is that you're shoving tubes up your kid's nose and you're doing all kinds of stuff and making them drink bleach. And you're being the martyr. It's your son who's tolerating all that rubbish.
Yeah.
You're not the martyr. But all these parents are out there like these amazing, you know, people put on pedestals.
Mm-hmm.
How? How? Have you even asked your child before doing all of this? And we have to. We have to.
Yes. Give them the choice and give them the control.
If we are saying that I believe in children's rights.
Yes, yes.
Then don't confuse the children's rights with your right to do whatever you feel like to your child. Don't confuse the two.
Of course.
Because everybody's learned to say the right things.
True.
Right. Yes. But are you practicing? Are you walking the talk?
True. Completely true. I agree with you. So the acceptance and the mentality needs to be, you know, changed, and the parents, they need to accept. The sooner they accept, sooner they realize, sooner they get aware and, you know, make people aware around themselves. So the miracle is their child, right? So
absolutely, absolutely. The child is the child, whatever he is.
Yes.
And when that acceptance is there,
mm-hmm.
that is what leads to happiness for the child and the parent. Because ultimately, what is it we want in life for our child?
Yeah, happiness and...
We want our child to be happy and fulfilled.
Yes.
And we forget that now. It's not to do with autism. It's also with typical kids.
Yeah, you know, the kid after
it's
all.
It's not to do with autism.
Yeah.
With all kids, what happens with parents is we have our perception of what we want our child to be.
Of course.
I want my child to be this doctor, or I want my child to be a lawyer like me, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's the same thing in autism, same thing with typical kids. It's not just a thing with parents of autistic kids. It's a universal thing, especially in India, of forcing our
vision.
Yes, what I want onto my child. Yes. And if that doesn't happen, being extremely unhappy and sad about it.
Of course, of course. True, true. The right chord, actually. Yeah. We need a different session to discuss this question, actually.
Absolutely.
So moving ahead, my next question doesn't seem so important now, but it's of relevance about the global pandemic. How has the COVID-19 pandemic impacted your work with children with disabilities and the families? And what adaptations have you made to continue providing support during this time and further? So,
right.
And little info about...
That's a very good question, actually. It's a very good question. Because it has been an important, an important event in the way we work with our kids. So, see, one of the things that the pandemic did for us, particularly at Action for Autism, we are great believers in the use of structure and visuals. Right? We know that that is the accommodation autistic people need, something that is not really well understood. Right? And like, for instance, with my son, I use structure at home. So during COVID, he had a clearly structured day, which made it easy for him to be able to handle it. It wasn't that he was doing whatever he felt like. Mm-hmm. Right? He was doing just like I didn't do whatever I felt like, sleeping anytime, getting up anytime. None of us did that, because then you'd go crazy. You can do that for a while, but not endlessly. So for those 2 years, I had a very structured life for him. And most of our kids at Action for Autism, parents, we advise them do the same, so that they are, and that is when a lot of parents realize how valuable and amazing this thing of structure is.
Yes.
So that was one. It helped a lot of parents to realize that. We also realized that how well our kids can learn online. As soon as we realized that this is not going to end soon, mm-hmm. we got cracking on figuring out how we can start teaching them. Mm-hmm. And again, because we use a very structured format, we were surprised. We all thought, you know, will our kids sit? Will they not sit? Will they attend?
Mm-hmm.
Amazingly attentive kids. There were a few exceptions who needed more support from their parents, but most of them sat happily and learned, right? So that was the other learning thing. And the wonderful thing that happened is that, see, the parents were also home. So when you're doing an online work, we had to, before, supposing if I'm going to be working with the kid tomorrow, today I had to send the parent all the information of what I'm going to do, what are the items the parents will have to keep ready,
mm-hmm.
how she will have to arrange it and keep it so the kid can learn.
Mm-hmm.
It helped the parents begin to understand their children much, much better. Because when I'm sending my kid off for the day, my involvement is not as much and my learning is not as much, unless for those parents who would come for workshops and stuff. So when we started doing this, the parents, they learned a lot. So that is something that they found very, very useful. So for a lot of parents, that was really a very important phase, because they really learned to understand their children. They learned how to support their children. And the other thing we realized is that you can really continue to use a lot of, and also, you know, like we spoke to our kids about COVID, and we never used this kind of, you know, oh, this terrible thing will happen, something will happen. We are very matter of fact in the way we teach our kids.
Mm-hmm.
So they all learn to handle the whole COVID thing, that, okay, this is something that happens, this is what I have to do, etc. Wearing their masks, mm-hmm. even at our assisted living, we run an assisted living.
Yeah.
So in 20, when the COVID was slightly low in 20, was it in 20, 21, 20, ah, no, in 21, we went on an outstation trip, and they all kept their masks on.
Okay.
I mean, and we had kids who'd be called severe.
Yeah.
Like, they kept their masks on when we were going out and stuff like that. So, you know, the thing is that it showed us that the kids can learn a lot. You know, there's this thing, you know, autistic kids, especially severe ones, won't learn.
Yeah.
There will be a few who will have a lot of challenges, but if you teach them the right way and you support them the right way, they will learn.
Mm-hmm.
And finally, the other great thing we realized is that we still have some of our programs continuing online. For instance, we place autistic adults in employment. So before that, we do an extensive training in soft skills, because autistic kids, they will learn the work that they have to do better than they will learn all the other things of how do I self-regulate, how do I ask for leave, how do I say that I'm feeling overwhelmed, I need a break, how do I say that, you know, I didn't understand what you said. So, which are very important skills to have, and not everybody is that verbal. So we do a soft skills training. And during COVID, we restarted that training, and we had people from other places outside Delhi attending the training. And we found we were training them well, and we were placing them through the online mode.
Yeah.
So now we continue to hold some of these trainings online.
Okay.
And we would never have learned if COVID had not happened.
Oh,
we
sure.
were doing the trainings face-to-face, all the trainings face-to-face.
Yes. Yes.
When this happened, we realized we could also do it online.
True.
And our kids learned that.
True.
So our kids taught us a lot, really.
Yes. So believing in their potentials and strengths. So it
you could always believe.
Learning.
You could always believe and do it. And then if they can't, then we'll see how we can teach them further. But you're going to start from a place of, yes, they can do it.
Yes. Believe. of course.
Yeah.
Now, coming to my next question is about some cherished moments or memories from your journey. Can you share a personal experience or moment that has been particularly meaningful or inspiring to you in your work with children with disabilities? There must be many, but...
I was just thinking there are so many.
Yes.
Yes, there are many. There are some where I still remember one that for me was very special is, my son did not speak. He was kind of non-speaking when he was young. Mm-hmm. And then he started speaking a little bit. But then he did very basic, mentioning the things that he wanted, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I kept trying to work on getting him to say, "I love you."
Okay.
Right. So the first time he said, "Love mama."
Okay.
Oh, he was in his teens.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
That for me was a very, very, very exciting moment. Even when he did not say it, it didn't matter to me.
Of
right?
Course.
Because I knew he loved me. Even mm-hmm. though he would push me away when I went near him, I knew it wasn't because he didn't love me. He mm-hmm. pushed me away because he was finding that proximity very mm-hmm. hard to deal with. Right, mm-hmm. which is what happens in autism.
Yeah.
So there were no judgments involved. But when he did say, "Love mama,"
yeah.
then that was fabulous.
Okay.
The other thing that I, for me, is very exciting is he stays in that assisted living that we've set up for adults.
Yes.
And so when I, when I go to visit, earlier for a lot of our kids, you come and go, they don't show any this thing.
Mm-hmm.
So now when I go, he will jump up, and not every time, he will jump up and come to me, or when I walk towards him, he will get up and then he'll give me a hug. And oh. he's very tall. He'll drape his head like a giraffe over my shoulder when he'll hug me. So, those feel very, very special.
Yes.
The other things that feel special is, I used to work hands-on a lot earlier. Now I don't do so much. I do very little now of that kind of stuff. So when I'm working with somebody, and the first time I've been working with the child to, for instance, get the child to match something, or get the child to vocalize something, or get the child to communicate that I want a biscuit. The first time that the child does it,
mm-hmm.
I mean, it's like, like there's so many of those moments,
True.
Anybody who works with our kids, because every moment is cherished and celebrated and is exciting.
True.
So, there are many moments like that. Also mm-hmm. moments when I've realized that when I say, my son used to have a lot of behaviors. He still does sometimes. And usually that is because there is some confusion in our communication. Mm-hmm. There has been sudden change. These things that we don't really think of. We see everything as challenging behavior.
Yeah.
And how do we change that challenging behavior?
Mm-hmm.
It's not a challenging behavior.
Mm-hmm.
The behavior is because my communication was not clear.
Mm-hmm.
There was something in the environment that was confusing. There was something that somebody said and did not keep to that word, and the person can't ask how it is, et cetera, et cetera.
Yes.
So you would have a lot of those things because it took me some time to really understand him. And our understanding of autism has matured now much more because we are speaking to so many autistic people who are telling us of their experiences,
mm-hmm.
which is really helping us a lot. So, there have been times when my son has really, been bothered and pushed something and completely destroyed something that I loved a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And it didn't bother me at all.
Uh-huh.
I loved it. It didn't bother me at all because, what is it? Because we work on that philosophy, but to see that I have been able to internalize it,
mm-hmm.
that what was it? It's just a material thing.
Mm-hmm.
How does it matter? It's a nothing. So those are, again, very good moments to feel that, because that's not just because of my son. That is also something that helps you in your own life.
Yes.
You learn what really matters and what doesn't.
Yes. Yes.
So those, again, I would say, moments that are important to me.
That's really heartening to know about them. And I also say that it's not your kids' therapy, it's your own therapy. You learn and grow.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, what you're saying, Shilpi, is so right.
Yes.
Because I think I have become a better person because my son has helped me rethink
True.
How I view things.
Yes.
Rethink how I value things around me. What do I value more?
Mm-hmm.
Right?
True.
So things that I would have probably learned by going on meditation or something like that, I've learned by just living my life with my son.
And he's all about human behavior and psychology, of course. Yeah.
And it has impacted everything. My interaction with other family members, my interaction with my colleagues, my interaction with my people who help me at home, mm-hmm. my interaction with a cab driver. Mm-hmm. You know, it impacts everything. True. And in a better way, in a much better way.
Of course. Makes you a better person as well. It makes you grow in certain way.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. True.
Absolutely.
Yes. So can we, just a moment.